and welcome back. You are watching the 2019 International WFTDA Playoffs live from Winston-Salem here in North Carolina. I'm Death Nella, joined by Steffi Skyscraper and our producer, Captain Double H. Ooh, oh, almost can see her lovely outfit. Oh, yeah, she made an appearance. Yes.
Did you ever get the feeling like you were being watched and you didn't know it? That's what I felt like there for a brief moment.
Came in a little early, but yes, you are watching the playoffs from Winston-Salem. Day two. Things are only going to get better from here on. Still plenty of derby. A reminder as well that we are being hosted by the wonderful Greensboro Roller Derby and the Women's Flat Track Derby Association.
It's been a great time here. This is the consolation bracket. Two teams that I think we're not expecting to be in this game are in it, looking to make the best of a situation. We're going to be seeing the number 7 seeded Windy City Rollers All-Stars going up against the number 5 seeded Santa Cruz Boardwalk Bombshells. And Death Nella, again, not really the game that they were expecting to be in, but looking to make the best of it. Obviously very close in ranking based off of their season. I think it's going to be a fun one.
And it's also going to be a memorable one, too. As you said, these teams not really expecting these games, but were really the storylines of yesterday.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Let's get right into
the roster. So, starting with Santa Cruz Derby Girls, they came in, of course, seeded number 5 in the tournament. Number 0018, Jem Jones. Number 1384, Heloise. Number 3, Ace Ventura. Number 33, R2 Detunate. Number 37, E-Rex. Number 4, Mad for Gravy. Number 444, Unleashed. Number 49, Cassie Beck. Number 626, Maddie Masochist. Number 707, Terra Tot. Number 8, Shamrock and Roller. That's your captain as well. Number 83, Killer V. Your alt skater is 89 High Roller. Number 9, Flower Power. Number 93, Jurassic Snark. And number 9999, Tifa Noxhard.
Your number 7 seed is the Windy City Roller All-Stars with number 116, Max Savage. Number 140 is Shake and Bake. Number 17 is Mia Goham, one of your alts. Number 187, Kickin' McChugget. Number 21 is Tricky Pixie. Number 24, Regina Spector. The Captain, number 312, is Killanoi. Killanoi. That's right. That's a running joke. That's a running joke that Double H has. Oh, my goodness. We're getting her involved in ways we didn't know. Number 350 is Rachel Rage. Number 413 is Malicious. Number 451 is Animal Link. Number 504, Phoebe Fife of Fum. Number 622 is Kidney Lopper. Number 75 is Bork Bork Bork. Number 77 is Vasquez. Number 8, Rita Hayworthy. And number 85 is Ice Hurt with number 9, Nicholas Rage as the...
And, of course, just had to chuckle there because Double H is sitting right beside us and had a moment of recognition like, oh, goodness.
Yeah, I my brain mentally recalled that. And I felt good saying it, but not really good after it. So,
Steffi, I'm really looking forward to this game as well because, of course, I was able to call the Santa Cruz game and you called the Windy game yesterday.
Which was fun, yeah. The Windy City Bear City game was a lot of fun. You had that Paris Santa Cruz game, which shook the tournament, busted 97% of the brackets.
Wild.
My goodness.
And so that's where we are today in this very exciting, consolation game, but we're about to get started now. And taking the line for Santa Cruz is number 8, Shamrock and Roller. Oh, rather, sorry. That is 626, Maddie Masochist, and Vasquez for Windy City. Vasquez trying to take the inside line quickly, doesn't quite make it, gets knocked to the inside of turn 1. I'm expecting that tough Santa Cruz defense that we saw all day yesterday. And right now, starting things off with a grind for both jammers.
And Windy City did lose a blocker to the boxes. Phoebe Fifo Fum committed a track cut, so a pack advantage in favor of Santa Cruz in the white.
Pack is spread out right now from turn 1 to turn 2. Lots of bridging in this entire tournament that I've been seeing, and it's an interesting decision.
Maddie Masochist was able to peel out that bridge there, able to get lead jammer status for Santa Cruz. Now it's in the pack, completion of the initial pass.
And the screen is still showing you turn 1. The pack not really moving all that much so far in this first jam. There was a penalty called there.
That is on number 1384, Heloise for Santa Cruz. So Pack Advantage will favor Windy City 4-on-3.
Vasquez still trying to connect, either to connect with her pivot, who is held up way at the front of the pack, being part of that three-braced wall. So these teams very evenly matched right now. Of course, this is just jam number one that we're seeing, but that's going to be the interesting story to play out, how they adjust to one another.
Maddie Maskus was able to complete the first scoring pass, 4 points put on the board for Santa Cruz. Maddie Maskus now back in on the second scoring pass with about 18 seconds left to go in the jam.
And it was Shamrock and Roller for Santa Cruz, drawing back Vasquez, still star in hand, still trying to work through that initial pass. A very intriguing first jam that ends up with 4 points for Santa Cruz, eight rather in total.
Yeah, very grinding defense played by both teams there to sort of constrain Windy City's jammer. Santa Cruz sort of holding things on there, as you can see Maddie Maskus trying to get out of this two-wall, and a nice push of the own teammate there by Bork to force the recycle there onto Maddie Maskus.
There has been some phenomenal work in that regard, the blockers knowing how to position their teammate to execute that hit out of bounds. And here we see E-Rex with the star for Santa Cruz. Those telltale yellow socks there, and Mia Goham for Windy City. And we have a multiplayer call on one of the Windy City blockers, but our Windy City jammer got a track cut call and has been sent to the penalty box. It's a power jam
long, as E-Rex is also taking a seat, so that will spring Mia Goham, and we are going to go the full 2 minutes, a minute 20 left to go in jam time.
A chance for Windy City to pick up some of those points. Oh, and a bit of a run on the outside lane proves to be unsuccessful, though, for Mia Goham. It's knocked out and dragged all the way back to turn two. Oh, but look at that. E-Rex able to capitalize on pretty much the exact same lane that was opened up there by her Santa Cruz teammates. E-Rex and Mia Goham right in the thick of the straightaway between turns two and three. This pack is unrelenting, not really giving much progress to anyone, but look at that. Mia Goham able to jump on through and is coming back for a scoring trip through the pack.
Yeah, able to get through, gets knocked to the infield there by Cassie Beck in the straightaway between two and three, and the jam called due to an injured skater. That is Mia Goham still down on the infield in turn number three.
And it appears there was contact obviously within the track. A little bit of contact on an official, but the decision was made for safety purposes, of course. The crowd now cheering as Mia Goham, on her own power, is skating off.
Quick response there by the medics as well. And for those of you curious, Papa Doc is here. We're always glad to see Papa Doc at one of our tournaments. And Mama Doc is also here as well. I saw them checking in. Papa Doc and Mama Doc have been a part of Windy City's medical staff for years and years and years. Of course, the parents of Varla Vendetta, a longtime Windy City skater who had retired just a couple of years ago, if I remember correctly. Always glad to see them. They are such great roller derby supporters and fantastic medics as well. Their response time is amazing. Well, so we're always lucky to have them.
Yeah, what a great story to have medics who are so involved and want to be here. And, of course, you can't have derby without them. So thank you.
Clock frozen at 25:50, but that will not happen for much longer as we start jam number three. 16-0 is the score in favor of Santa Cruz's Terra Tot, jamming against Ice Hurt for their respective teams.
And it's the first time. Oh, look at that. Windy City, Ice Hurt out in front with lead. Terra Tot about a half lap behind. Now the pack speeding up. We haven't really seen this so far in the game.
Windy City loses Bork to a multiplayer block as Ice Hurt calls off the jam after scoring 1 point for Windy City to put them on the board.
Okay, but Windy City now, points on the board. Feeling good about their effort to at least shut out Santa Cruz there.
Sometimes getting that zero off the board is the hardest part. That's where you get the momentum started, just getting that zero off here.
And
as you see.
Yeah.
See in the replay that Teratot trying to get in through, forcing the call off by entering the pack, but did not get through to score points in time.
And we have some new jammers once again. Well, not new, their first time in this bout, rather. T for Knoxhard for Santa Cruz. And Killinoy for Windy City.
But I promise I will not say that little secret again. But Killinoy taking a seat in the penalty box. And there's a forearm penalty for Killinoy. So power jam for Santa Cruz and Tifa Knoxhard.
But it is number 350, Rachel Ray, with the bump on the jammer to the inside, slowing things down, possibly being able to execute a decent penalty kill. And sure, Tifa Knoxhard gets through with 4 points, but Killinoy is standing in the penalty box right now.
Pork, pork, pork is back in as well, so it is full strength in the packs. The only thing we're missing is Killinoy, and she is returning back onto the track at this time.
And taking a little bit of a longer way in, probably wants to build up some momentum before tackling that. Oh, yes, taking on that Santa Cruz Walsh, coming at it with force. Getting a little bit of assistance there by 622 Kidney Lauper.
I like where your brain was going there, though. 4 points picked up there by Tifa Knoxhard, who has completed her second scoring pass as Killinoy has completed the initial on route to score. And Knoxhard calls off the jam there for Santa Cruz. No points scored by Windy City. So it's going to be 25-1, 9 points scored as Tifa Knoxhard was able to get 1 point there. And you can see on the replay, Tifa Knoxhard able to get through on the inside and, actually gets kind of stopped up, goes to the outside. Great footwork there by Tifa Knoxhard to sort of move in and out.
And it's always a very positive sign, too, if you're watching these jammers from home and wondering, how do they stay in bounds? Watch the direction of their hips as well. It's usually facing into the track. And as I'm talking, Vasquez for Windy City picks up lead and is already coming around for a scoring trip through the pack. Oh, my goodness. So quickly right down the outside lane there into turn one, picking up 4 points on the toe stops.
Two different alleyways as well, because the inside lane to get lead, the outside lane to get the first scoring pass completed. And now on the second scoring pass is Vasquez.
In case you're wondering why that lateral movement is so important, that's exactly why.
I mean, lateral movement, footwork, it's all here in this game.
But now Vasquez kind of getting stuck where she was held the last time she was out here. There has been a penalty called on the Windy City pivot. Meanwhile, a star stash helps Maddie Masochist out, who's coming back for a scoring trip through the pack. But Vasquez with a very quick call off, and yes, it is in time to shut out Santa Cruz for that jam and pick up two more points for a total of 6 for Windy City.
So on the replay here, you can see that Vasquez, outside lane, toe stop work galore, coming into turn number one off the pivot line. That was how 4 points were picked up. And we move into our next jam, which will be brought to you by Radar Wheels. The WFTDA playoffs are proudly sponsored by Radar Wheels, and Radar Halo is the number one wheel in all of roller derby.
And we have Shake and Bake with a start for Windy City. E-Rex out there for Santa Cruz. And, oh, a track cut call for Shake and Bake. Thought she was out with lead, but no, off to the penalty box. Just about to sit down while E-Rex still working her way through the top of the pack. Santa Cruz playing a passive offense there. Didn't really bode well because E-Rex is finding a little bit of trouble here.
Bork, bork, bork. Also taking a seat for a directional penalty. So that means pack advantage 4-on-3 plus the power jam in favor of Santa Cruz.
But E-Rex still working on that initial pass. Windy City doing that two-person blocking. Oh, and a track cut call now on E-Rex. Will cost her a trip right as she completed her initial end. Shake and Bake had been released from the penalty box already.
So this is going to go the full 2 minutes with a minute left to go in jam time. And now Shake and Bake on the completion, the first scoring pass now beginning, or sorry, completion of the initial, now on the first scoring pass.
And trying to get a little bit of help from the offense.
Bork, bork, bork opened up a lane there by moving R2D to Nate, but then Shake and Bake got trapped up in the three wall there of Santa Cruz.
And we have once again, a more passive offense from those skaters, but that's because they're getting ready for Erex to come in. Erex taking a spill. They're on turn four to the inside. Meanwhile, Shake and Bake coming back to collect more points, but gets hit out by number 3-3.
That's R2D to Nate once again. R2D to Nate did go out as well, but great movement there by her to get back in.
Yeah, that phenomenal track awareness. Both of these teams understanding where exactly they fell out of place and re-entering, and where does that land us after all that movement? 4 points for Windy City there and two for Santa Cruz. Oh, rather five for Windy City, picked up an additional.
Well, no, eight. We weren't done counting. There was so much adding to do.
We're just so excited. We won't tell you all the numbers.
The most important part right now is 27 for Santa Cruz and 15 for Windy City with 19 minutes left to go here in the first half of action. And you can see here on the replay coming up. The replay went so fast I couldn't even call it. We're back in live action here. It's Ice Hurt against Terra Tot off the jammer line. Full complement of blockers on the track as well.
Yes, we're seeing Windy City trying to provide some offense there closer to the start. Meanwhile, Terra Tot being recycled back. And we do have a cut track call assessed to Ice Hurt from Windy City. Not feeling good about that one, of course. Opening things up for Terra Tot, who just assessed lead jammer. We'll see if Santa Cruz is able to execute offense here. Oh, but Terra Tot unable to get by number 2-4 for Windy City. That's Regina Spector.
Nice nudge out there by Max Savage to force the call off by Terra Tot. So yeah. Santa Cruz is going to pick up 4 points at the end of jam number 7. And we move into jam number 8. We'd like to thank Derby Without Borders, a charity project dedicated to smashing the barriers of accessibility to roller derby around the world by providing leagues with coaching, support, and equipment. And there you see in the replay, a lot of great footwork, a lot of great recycling in this entire tournament, really.
And a smart decision as well to try this power start. They have about 7 seconds before Windy City's jammer is going to be released. So an opportunity for Santa Cruz to grab lead. But right as I say that, Ice Hurt is now back on the track.
If it knocks hard, the jammer for Santa Cruz. Trapped up in a braced wall there of Windy City and trying to get some assistance there from a blocker of Santa Cruz.
Do they know that the entire track can be used? Because I swear that turn is getting all the
action.
It's
a popular turn
this
weekend.
Yes, it is. It's because the defense, as you can see, grinding things to a halt. The jammer's not quite figuring out how to get by those walls. Although, as I say that, Windy City getting a bit of assistance there.
Yeah, good movement by Kidney Lopper to break up the Santa Cruz defense there.
And the pack still working to stop that Windy City jammer right at the front. Ice Hurt. Lead jammer has not been assessed yet.
R2D tonight had to drop back to keep Cassie Beck in play. And Cassie Beck declared out of play. Lead jammer status going to Ice Hurt of Windy City.
I mean, we have seen a lot of one-on-one blocking this weekend, but Cassie Beck holding on, slowing things down for an additional, 10 seconds at least?
Knowing Cassie Beck's reputation of one-on-one blocking, that's not a surprise.
Ice Hurt, though, trying to get through now to score points, but right as that happens, there was a stash by Tifa Knoxhard and a track cut, so that's sending her to the penalty box with star in hand.
It's about 20 seconds left to go here in the jam for Ice Hurt on the first scoring pass to do some damage. 16 points of separation between the two teams. I don't know if that can, that definitely can't be made up in 10 seconds, but at least they can close the gap up.
And Ice Hurt deciding, we're going to do what Santa Cruz did to us. Keep that jammer in the penalty box to end the jam.
Give it a nice power start after picking up 3 points. So it's 31-18 in favor of Santa Cruz with about 15 and a half minutes left to go as we move into jam number 8, which will be sponsored by S1 Helmets. Durable, functional, and stable. The S1 Pro knee pads are built for roller derby. You can find them on the web at S1.com or S1Helmets.com.
And we have Killanoise out there for Windy City taking on this power start with a fast drive up. It worked out well, that pivot line start with her blockers, because she was able to capitalize and is now coming around right as Tifa Knoxhart has been released from the penalty box.
Yeah, that fast drive up really provided a lot of space for Killanoi to get through. I mean, you can't give her that much space. She will find those lanes.
Yeah, she committing right out of the penalty box to take that inside lane, unfortunately taking a bit of a spill between turns one and two. So now the pack is spreading out, making things very difficult for Tifa Knoxhart to get through on that initial, while Killanoi is not having an easy time up front with those two Santa Cruz blockers. That's 444 unleashed.
4-on-3 pack advantage now favoring Windy City as Shamrock and Roller takes a seat for a multiplayer block. But yeah, as you mentioned, kind of getting stuck in the pack now in the front is Killanoi. Able to get around, 4 points picked up by Windy City.
That was Maddie Masochist up there with that one-on-one blocking to slow things down again. Really chewing into prime scoring time, right?
Not so much on that one.
Yes. Able to sneak by that time around.
Four additional points picked up, 8 points on the jam so far. Still 40 seconds left to go on jam time.
The pack now still working into turn three, right in front of the crowd here in Winston-Salem.
And back block penalty called on Killanoi. That's going to end the that's going to end lead jammer status for Windy City and move it to a power jam for Maddie Masochist, who has received the star pass.
And there has been a direction of play called on one of the Windy City blockers.
That's Max Savage for Windy City.
So right now we have power jam situation for Maddie Masochist. Well, of course, now the jam has come to its natural conclusion. And there has been a timeout called by Santa Cruz.
That will freeze the clock at 13:18 as you take a look here at the replay. Tifa Knoxhart getting down there by number 24, Regina Spector. And then Max Savage coming right up to try and block things out as Windy City just completely shutting down Tifa Knoxhart entirely. And as mentioned, Santa Cruz taking their first team timeout. 10 points on the jam for Windy City, making it 31-28.
And here we have another look at the Windy City jammer. I believe this is the moment where that back block occurred, understanding what happened and finding her way to the penalty box. And of course, she'll be starting in the penalty box, still seated for the, before this next jam.
And that next jam will be brought to you by Adam Skates. Have you tried the Adam Savant wheels? See what you've been missing? Go to adamskates.com for more information.
And you know what? This might be a good time to go through our officials, perhaps. Oh, no, right as I said that, the whistle blows.
Well, you say so officials and they blow a whistle. So
like,
I mean,
you're talking about us?
Yeah, yes. Tweet.
So we will be mentioning our fantastic officials in just a moment.
We'll say some things about them later. Don't
worry. But at first, we're going to see E-Rex handle this power start, see how she's going to capitalize on it. Bit of a pileup of all different blockers there, and it works
the
perfectly.
Great vision there on the outside lane there for E-Rex to take and get lead jammer status for Santa Cruz. Now time to start that first scoring pass.
Yeah, that's how you organize chaos to your advantage, and E-Rex easily taking the inside lane on the toe stops while Killanoi is now back on the track, star in hand, weaving her way through the initial pass. Perhaps able to use that same sort of chaotic cluster that was happening to stop the sort of grinding down defense that Santa Cruz is so known for. We have lots of action happening here, plenty of penalties as well.
Yeah, Windy City losing two of their skaters, specifically that one of them is the pivot, number 622, Kenny Lauper, in the box, and Bork, Bork, Bork going to the box. Both of them are on their third penalty as Santa Cruz picks up 8 points in the jam.
There's that moment, that swift apex jump for E-Rex to keep getting by and pick up more points. And Steffi, on the note of penalty, Santa Cruz Derby girls sitting with 8 total so far. Windy City with 17.
And more importantly, I think on the 17 penalties for Windy City, 5 of those are jammer penalties, and that has cost them 2 lead jammer statuses. As we are now in an official timeout, what better time to talk about officials?
Hey, so would you like to take it away with the skating officials?
The skating officials are head referee for this game is Razor, along with Refty Venture, PH Demon, Shanksy, Adam Smasher, RDFM, gym class hero, and the alt ref is Oliver Pist.
And for our non-skating officials...
Ooh, can I say
yes,
the crew head ref?
Do.
Because she's my league mate. I know how to say it. It's Le Cabrusier.
Le Cabrusier.
Yeah.
John Brawls, Judge Booty, Big Brad Wolf, Diamond Tiara, This Will Be Painful, Sod Op, Petey, Rule Booker, Oh My Az, and W.E.B. Destroys.
There you go.
Thank you to everyone involved with officiating and being non-skating officials. We love you. We couldn't do Derby without you, so thank you.
We're so glad to have them. It's a clock frozen at 12 minutes, 10 seconds. You can see here on the replay, E-Rex got nudged out there by Kidney Lopper, and Kidney Lopper ran back to force things out. Just great maneuvering all the way around in this game. A 39-26 game with about 18 minutes coming off the clock. Great low-scoring game. This is the kind of game that I always love calling.
Yes, it's definitely a match, and in terms of the strength and the abilities of these teams, but Santa Cruz, of course, wanting to edge it out and grabbing lead there. Terratot out in front, already coming back to score while Vasquez works through her initial, but makes it by.
Vasquez did a great move to get Santa Cruz pivot out of play and force the force that out of play call, get the initial pass completed, and force the call off there, but 4 points still scored by Santa Cruz.
Yeah, Ace Ventura was the pivot there for Santa Cruz, doing her best up at the top of the pack. And one thing in our next break, or even if you can see it, Steffi, as it's happening, I'd love to discuss more of the offensive opportunities these teams could have. Look at that.
That,
Santa
like
Cruz.
That situation yeah. right there. That was a perfect one. You saw it on the replay. As we now move into action once again, it's going to be Tifa Noxhar jamming against Shake and Bake for their respective teams.
And it's Tifa out with lead in front. So now the pack's speeding up a little bit for this jam here. Already moving into turn three, but still keeping Shake and Bake locked up against their wall. And as I say that, Tifa Noxhart is also finding, oh, look at that, out, able to escape that bad place up against the outer line.
4 points picked up by Tifa Noxhart as she is now starting her second scoring pass. R2 detonate holding control of the brace now. Basically the one blocker in control. Great move maneuvering there to down Shake and Bake. And then great reformation there by Santa Cruz to get back into the brace triangle.
Shake and Bake just being like jello and simply moving between the blockers. Of course, it does take time. Oh, and she does get tripped up there, stepping out of bounds.
Good drawback there by Jim Jones to send Shake and Bake all the way back into the straightaway between two and three.
But both jammers coming up against very similar defenses here as Tifa Noxhard. It's wondering, do I keep going? Do I call this off? Looking at her bench right now.
Shake and Bake still on the initial, if I'm not mistaken. So, I mean, you might as well at this point. You're taking time off the clock, and you're still on your second scoring pass. You're still, you may not have be picking up points now because you may have already scored all the possible points, but keep that clock running. In this kind of a low-scoring environment, you're not doing much but just take time off the clock, although they decided to call the jam off in this instance.
Well, you're right, Steffi, and perhaps one of the advantages to calling it off is the fact that they're going to start with a pack advantage, one of the Windy City blockers standing in the penalty box right now. Also interesting to see that the Windy City pivot, I mean, they couldn't help at all. It was just a grind out there.
Yeah, so general decision there made by the entire team of Santa Cruz to call that one off after scoring 8 points. So 51-28 with 9 minutes left to go here in the first half is Maddie Maskus jamming against Ice Hurts.
And as I say that, Windy City's back to full strength in the pack as well.
You know, the call-off actually did make sense because Windy City had a blocker still in the box, so calling it off still gave him the pack advantage. That did make a lot of sense.
And Maddie Mask is coming up now for her scoring trip through the pack.
This will be the fourth straight jam where Santa Cruz has gotten lead, and they have used it to great advantages. They've picked up, looks like 20 points in those last four jams, and now making it 24, the four-point pass. Easy for me to say.
And as you say that, Ice Hurt is able to get out, now coming back to collect points. But Maddie is going to make sure that does not happen, calling it off. Picking up 2 points for that effort there, bringing Santa Cruz's total for the game up to 57. Windy City at 28.
So more than double the total here with 8 minutes left to go here in the first half. And you can follow along with live game updates and matchups at my favorite website, stats.wftda.com. You can forecast game results, keep up with who's playing who and when, see how the playoffs affect live rankings, all at stats.wftda.com.
And we start this jam with E-Rex on the line for Santa Cruz, already picking up lead jammer status, able to take the inside line there. Killanoy for Windy City, once again getting caught up in the cluster of blockers. That seems to work well for Santa Cruz. E-Rex able to navigate quite easily through that. Killanoy now about a half lap behind, coming in to look for points.
You didn't see it on the screen there, definitely, but there was great awareness there by E-Rex to pay attention to where Killanoy was and try to basically wait for the time, wait for the approach, call it off, melt a couple seconds off the clock. Great, and you see it in the replay, great footwork by E-Rex to sort of stay on the toe stops, hop through on the outside lane, not get knocked out of bounds. Just fantastic work all around by Santa Cruz, especially in the last five jams.
Yeah, that awareness to know, okay, I am going to essentially draw out every single second I possibly can of this jam. As we move into this one, Teratot with the star for Santa Cruz, Vasquez on the line for Windy City.
This will snap the lead jammer streak. No pass, no penalty. Still eligible to score, though, is Teratot.
And lead jam called, assessed to Vasquez and called off immediately, opting to shut out Santa Cruz there.
That's smart track awareness there by Vasquez to get the lead and call it right away, knowing that lead was not assessed, but also knowing that Teratot was in position to score. It's great track awareness.
And there we see the moment the no earned pass occurred, deciding, you know what, I'm not going to wait and re-enter and try to get lead. I am just going to go for it.
Yeah, worst case scenario, you just take some time off the clock. Best case scenario, you can continue to rack up points. Go for it.
And look at that. Ice Hurt now out with lead.
So now that's two in a row for Windy City as they start to rebuild momentum. Tifa Noxhard still trapped up in the pack coming into turn number one.
And there will be a track cut penalty assessed. Ice Hurt thought that she had seeded enough, but tricky work by Santa Cruz. Drawing back just far enough to draw that track cut call. So this is a power jam for Tifa Noxhard, but still working through her initial up against number 622 there from Windy City. That's Kidney Lopper has just been in everyone's way today.
And that's going to be the sixth box trip for Windy City's jammers as well, and the third lost lead.
When you look at the difference in points and you think about all those power jams that Windy City afforded Santa Cruz, and those numbers sort of get made up in those jams.
Yeah, and you also look at the turning moment as well. Santa Cruz took that team timeout, and that's really when I think that reversal of fortune happened. I kind of wonder if Windy City might want to consider using one of their timeouts. They still have all three of their stoppages as well as their official review, and about 4.5 minutes left to go with about 47 seconds left to go on jam time for jam number 16.
It's one of those things in video review you'll watch back and notice the clock management. And as I say that, Tifa Noxhard out on her initial.
Just once, I'd like the announcer curse to be for a timeout and not for a penalty.
And Ice Hurt in turn three, not being told to call it, trying to pick up some points, but wow, coming up against Cassie Beck and number three, Ace Ventura. The pack now moving into turn four.
Slow-moving pack here as both teams playing exclusive defense. Well, I say that, and then Bork, Bork, Bork levels Cassie back to free up Ice Hurt. 4 points scored on both sides.
And we have an official review being used as a timeout for Windy City. So, hey,
well, is
look
that?
At that.
Wait a minute. Well, let's take a look at the replay here. You can see this is where Tifa Noxhard got loose on the inside, outside lane.
Just incredible track awareness.
So this is the official review being used as a timeout. You know what? If Windy City's bench staff wants to buy me a Diet Dr. Pepper, I will not turn it down.
I am fine with this. So that's going to freeze the clock at 3 minutes and 46 seconds. Santa Cruz 65, Windy City 32. You know, if you want to be a part of the Champs 3000, Crew VIP tickets unfortunately are already sold out to Ethnella, so I can't get one. Yeah. Even though I'm the tournament head announcer, I can't even get one. This stinks.
Well, that
but there are still three-day passes available for the 2019 International WFTDA Championships in Montreal. That is going to be November 15th through the 17th. Don't miss your chance to join us in person for this monumental event. Get your tickets now at wftda.com/tickets.
I feel like VIP is a state of mind, but of course you don't have access to any of the
I am a very important princess. This is very important to know.
And here we have another look at Vasquez. Not seeding, or rather just not seeing that Santa Cruz skater had drawn back just as she re-entered the track. Oh, ice hurt, rather. Thank you, Double H.
Apologies. She's so helpful. She helps us in so many ways, this Double H. Maddie Maskus out there jamming for Santa Cruz against Illinois for Windy City.
And Santa Cruz back on track with lead jammer status assessed to Maddie Maskus.
Illinois still trapped up in the pack there, getting held back by Shamrock and Roller, and now getting joined by two additional blockers from Santa Cruz. One is Heloise.
Well, this pack seems to not want to separate at all. They're all clustering together, of course, making it difficult for both jammers to get by. And now we have R2-D2 Nate, the last line of defense, but a star pass to Regina Spector there for Windy City gets her through on the initial.
Santa Cruz will lose Unleashed to the penalty box for a multiplayer block, so this is a 4-on-3 pack advantage for Windy City.
And there is a lot of noise in this venue right now. Fans are getting excited, trying to figure out what's going on. And as I mentioned that, Regina Spector taking a seat in the penalty box.
Yeah, for a back block penalty, specifically hit on Heloise.
Maddie Matzik is still trying to fight through, but Windy City losing blockers to the penalty box as well. It has just been a story of penalties for Windy City. They're now totaling 22 for this half, 12 for Santa Cruz Derby Girls.
You can see here coming up on the replay, this is Maddie Maskus with the call off, able to get around Max Savage. You ever wonder how to call it off while getting that last point, get your hips around, and still keep your feet in bounds? Go back and watch that replay.
Mm-hmm. And then remember that one up. Then remember that likely the first time you do that, you're not even thinking of anything, but I need to call the jam off.
A smart call off, too, because it keeps Regina Spector in play as the jammer for Windy City here, as we have a minute 44 left in the half and a minute 46 now on jam time. E-Rex out there for Santa Cruz.
E-Rex coming up against, once again, Kidney Lauper. But out of play called, and lead jammer assessed to E-Rex once more.
E-Rex with an adjustment of the knee pad there as well.
Yeah, she's sitting at a 100% lead percentage, E-Rex, in this first half. Already coming in to collect points. But a multiplayer block called on one of the Windy City jammers. I'm just going to see the number
Windy
there.
Windy City blocker there is blocker? Rachel Rage is going to take a seat. So pack advantage favoring Santa Cruz, 4-on-3.
Yeah, you know, there's only one jammer. Oh, boy. And now we're resetting, still there in turn one. E-Rex.
Star was passed to Kidney Lauper there. I almost said Cindy Lauper as well. We're thinking about great music in the background.
Yes, we are. E-Rex through with 4 points for Santa Cruz.
So still a 7-second difference between the jam clock and the clock for the half. So if this runs the full 2, we will go into the half. Unless something weird happens, who knows? Yeah. Rachel Rage going back into the penalty box, this time for illegal contact.
Yeah, she was able to contact E-Rex in the air while E-Rex was doing an apex jump, but despite the penalty, it did slow E-Rex down. She had to go all the way to the back of the pack and start again. And that's happening once more. The jam coming to an end there.
Jam got called as Santa Cruz will add an additional 3 points. So that will take us into the half, as I drop my pen. It's 76-32, and really,
Those last few jams was just a huge thing. And there's the illegal contact. And that hit out of bounds, that hit through the apex jump happened while Rachel Rage was out of bounds. Looks like one more point was assessed. So 77 to 32 now the score. Wow. That was a heck of a first half, especially in the second half of the first half. So once Santa Cruz called that timeout and then peeled off like six straight jams of incredible scoring, you can see here on this replay, great maneuvering there to get E-Rex recycle back. Just great work by Windy City. They're playing great defense. It's just...
they need to stay on the track, Steffi.
Yeah,
we're going to talk more about this when we come back from the halftime break, so stick around, WFTDA.TV. I'm Death Nella with Steffi Skyscraper and Double H. We'll be back with more action coming right up. Santa Cruz taking on Windy City. Two teams with upsets yesterday.
Yeah, but not the side of the upset you want to be on. Of course, Santa Cruz fell to Paris in the bracket-busting upset. And Windy City fell to Bear City. They're in this game, obviously not really the one they were hoping to be in, but making the best of an unfortunate situation. Santa Cruz really, in that first half, they called a timeout right before jam number 10.
Fantastic timing.
Then they peeled off 39 points, somewhere around that range. They had a ridiculous streak of lead jammer statuses that went to them. They had six in a five in a row. Then they had a no pass, no penalty that would have given them the lead. Mm-hmm. But it was really, really a great call timeout. Things went really well for Santa Cruz after that. That was really where they opened up. And now they have that lead, 77-32.
And Steffi, I took a moment just to look online to see how people are feeling about this game. And we talk about it being a consolation game, but there's so many fantastic moments in this game.
Yeah.
This is phenomenal defensive derby. I'm going to step in and say Windy City can certainly take opportunities to do a little bit more offense where possible, but that grinding out defense has also helped keep Santa Cruz at bay for a number of jams.
Well, as Talk Talk would say, life's what you make of it. Well,
exactly.
That's not exactly how that went. But, you know, life is what you make it. And in this situation, you've got a game that you can play. You make the most of it. And that's exactly what Santa Cruz and Windy City are doing right now. Santa Cruz has Maddie Maskus out there jamming against Ice Hurt for Windy City.
And we are starting the half with Santa Cruz leading 77, Windy City at 32. And it is Santa Cruz out with lead jammer status to start the second half. And this will be the second half of play for both these teams for the rest of the tournament.
Yeah, after this, they go to the hotel pool, enjoy themselves, come back, watch more roller derby.
I was just going to say, and just like the folks at home, can settle in for a whole one day more's worth of roller derby. Took a roundabout way to get there, and we are now watching the action on turn two. There's that defense by Windy City, and there's nothing wrong with playing obviously a defensive minded game. There's so many notes people can be taking right now when you're looking at those braced walls. Maddie Masakis taking a step back to try to take a step forward, not really getting anywhere, but same goes for Ice Hurt, the star for Windy City. And Windy City unable to capitalize on star passes either because of that really defensive play. So Ice Hurt now.
This is a lot of the same gameplay that we saw in the first half as well, and we're seeing it resume here. And a lot of physical gameplay, which is, this is what I think is causing Windy City to have a lot of trouble with their blockers in the penalty box, as they lost Rachel Rage to a forearm penalty in that, which gave Santa Cruz the pack advantage.
And here we see a replay moment of Maddie Masakis juking those shoulders around, staying inbounds. Just notice how she positions her hips to the direction that she wants to stay. So that's why she's always pointing in towards the track, staying inbounds and upright. And we have on the line here
E-Rex going up against Vasquez, the respective teams.
Should have noticed the yellow socks, although as I say that, I notice that the yellow socks are headed to the penalty box. That was for a head block call. or blocking with a head call, rather.
That was close. Those words were similar. As Vasquez now still in the pack, looking for an outside lane to try and pick up lead, now moving to the inside.
Whoa, and Vasquez with some fancy footwork, or really just fast backward skating, able to get by the hips of the Santa Cruz blocker up at the front and already coming back to collect points.
This is sort of the break Windy City needs right now. Every lead jammer status right now is a positive momentum builder for Windy City, especially if they can get some multiple scoring pass jams.
And drawing penalties on Santa Cruz. Cassie Beck now taking a seat in the penalty box alongside another one of her teammates. And R2D2Nate also sent to the box, but sent right back on the track. No room yet for her to serve her penalty.
R2D2Nate did a very smart thing there. You saw it at the bottom of the screen. She put her hand out to tap the outside pack ref to let her know that she was coming in the back as well.
And Windy City choosing that moment to collect four more points and freeze those two, actually now three, Santa Cruz blockers in the box because there's two standing skaters right now.
So a huge jam there for Windy City. 12 points picked up to Santa Cruz's four as... Here, I believe, is where you're going to see the cut for E-Rex.
Or was it blocking with the head call?
Yeah, you're right. No, that was right. That was a blocking with the head call. Sorry, I looked at the wrong column.
And so now we have the power start, of course, for Killanoy. And she is able to get by that solo Santa Cruz blocker out on the track to assess the lead now. Santa Cruz almost up to full strength. Only one blocker in the penalty box right now.
That is R2D2Nate, who is serving her penalty after being sent back out.
Killanoy still finding it difficult, though, to get by. Oh, right, as I say that, freed through the inside lane there in turn one, and the crowd going wild, while Maddie Masochist also drawn all the way back to turn four.
Not often was there a situation where you can sneak past Cassie Beck like that, but Killanoy was able to find one.
And these blockers, both on the same team and the opposing, making it difficult for the jammers because they're all clustered up on the straightaway.
Nice hit by Mac Savage. Just a nice nudge out to send Maddie Masochist out and a recycle back to the jammer line.
And that Windy City wall just unrelenting. That's Mac Savage out in the back with Rita Hateworthy. And Maddie Masochist deciding, I am going to push down to try to break through this wall. It's only strengthening them up. Now it looks like she's waiting for Killanoy to get into play.
Yeah, I like what Killanoy does when she gets recycled back. She goes back about 10, 15, maybe sometimes even 20 feet to give herself some spacing and build up momentum so it's not like she's having to come in from a dead start.
The pack slowly crawling from turn one into turn two. Those jammers trying to find some open lanes, not much room. Maddie Masochist having to put in so much effort in the last 15, 20 seconds of that jam. Timeout being called by Santa Cruz. And here we see that moment.
You can see where Killanoy gets knocked down and then gets floored there in the pack by Shamrock and Roller. And then comes back. And then down Shamrock and Roller and gains the scoring pass. So timeout called by Santa Cruz. This is going to be their second team timeout. This is where we want to remind you the semifinals are coming up next, but there is a 30-minute spacer between this game and the semifinals. So the semifinals will start at 6:30. The first game will be Texas and Dos Por Cuatro. And then that's going to be at 6:30. The 8:30 game will be between Rainy City and Angel City. So make sure you come back from that. There's plenty of time to go get your dinner.
I was going to say there's plenty of time to go, you know, call up your friends, them over.
Have
a
pizza party.
Watch party. Love doing that when I'm at home.
What, having pizza parties?
Yes.
I have a pizza party all the time.
Well, I just meant, you know, getting together and watching live streams.
I'm all about the one woman pizza party, you know.
It's just a party because there's pizza. It doesn't matter how many people there are.
It's a party all the time wherever I'm at. I'm saying.
Oh, yes, exactly.
Just how it is. So we come back into action, clock frozen at 24:05, but it will not last much longer as Santa Cruz sending Tiva Noxhard to jam against Ice Hurt for Windy City, and it looks like we are at full strength in the packs.
Of course, first half, there was a bit of a penalty spiral on the Windy City side. We will be keeping a close eye on those numbers, but...
I've already have. It's only two so far.
Ah.
Compared to five for Santa Cruz, so it's like a reversal of fortune. They swap places.
And so we'll see how the timing of that timeout works again for Santa Cruz like it possibly did in the first half.
It's almost like Freaky Friday, except it's Saturday.
And Tifa knocks hard with the star for Santa Cruz, still working through the pack at the back, while Ice Hurt is trying to get by. Oh, there's R2-D2, Nate. And number four, that's Matt for gravy. Matt for blocking, rather. And there's a multiplayer called on Mad for Gravy. And that will allow Ice Hurt to get by R2-D2, Nate.
Third straight lead jammer status for Windy City as they are starting to claw their way back into this one. Ice Hurt now coming in on the first scoring pass. Gets nudged out by Cassie Beck, but good maneuvering there by Bork 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 to try to block up Cassie Beck, but Cassie Beck recycled all the way back into turn number two.
After working all the way up that straightaway, slow pace. Now, of course, the timing works for Santa Cruz because if the pack is slow and things go slow, but both jammers are kept at bay. Oh, big hit. The crowd erupts there by turn two. Tifa Knoxhart still trying to get through on that initial star in hand.
4 points scored here for Windy City as they are going to start their second scoring pass in just a quick moment.
Yeah, Ice Hurt already coming back to collect points while Tifa Knoxhart is pretty much right where we left her on the track before, trying to fight through those walls.
And Ice Hurt decides she's going to call off the jam after picking up an additional 3 points. So two scoring passes completed. Well, somewhat completed. I mean, the call-off completes the scoring pass.
And now we're seeing a look at that moment when Ice Hurt is getting by him. That's Tifa Knoxhart. That's the big hit there. Yeah, the reaction from the crowd was pretty...
Ooh, I love the close-ups on the crowd when everybody goes, ah! It's just kind of...
Those are front row seats to all
of that. That's in our fan zone here at the Winston-Salem Fairgrounds Annex as Terratot now jamming up against Vasquez as we have palindrome on the scoreboard. It's 58-85 in favor of Santa Cruz. It's 21-21 left to go in the first game, I should say.
The view from the announcer booth shows two teams looking like each other's mirror right now, both using that really defensive heavy play, and then in the meantime
back block called on Sydney Lauper
and Tertot has been sent to the penalty box as well. That's a jammer penalty for Santa Cruz. So Vasquez now with a power jam, still working through her initial trip through the pack.
Forearm penalty has been called and it will be assessed to Animal Lee. So 4-on-3 pack advantage favoring Santa Cruz.
But Unleashed and Heloise not making it easy at all. Closing up every possible lane you could think of. And as I say that, Terratot is now back on the track. Able to get right into the action because it's happening in the straightaway leading into turn one. And a cut track penalty now called to Vasquez.
Well, that ends the power jam.
And that will also mean this jam will run to its full conclusion. Only 30 seconds left.
Yeah, jam number five will end in 30 seconds as we continue on here as Terratot trying to work through.
They're still in turn one. The pack hardly moving. They've been able to keep the jammers in their own pockets, really.
Yeah, the pack's basically decided we like it here.
Yeah, this is our comfort zone. We know the floor and the surrounding here, a really great view for the fan zone as well. And with that, the jam winds down to its natural conclusion. And there's 3 points on the board for Santa Cruz.
See in the replay as Vasquez coming in and gets nudged out. And I believe this is where we see the cut.
Shamrock and Roller with that hit and drag back. Phenomenal track awareness and work to close out those lanes. There's nowhere to go.
That entire 2 minutes, and that was only 3 points the entire time. It's 88-58 as we move into jam number six of the second half. 19 minutes left to go in the game as R2-D2 Nate is about to take a seat in the penalty box for a direction penalty.
Meanwhile, Bork, Bork, Bork slow down E-Rex, and Killanoy is already out with lead jammer status for Windy City. Coming back to score points, Pack has not moved past turn one. And we'll see lots of closed lanes now as E-Rex is trying to either pass the star or just try to get through with star in hand right now.
A quick correction, R2 detonate's penalty was a multiplayer block, not a direction.
E-Rex still trying to find some help. Her pivot is there in the mix while Killanoy looking to score some points.
E-Rex is still trapped up in turn number one as Killanoy trying to get out of turn two, but gets recycled back by Santa Cruz all the way into turn number one as the star has been passed to R2 detonate.
And that will lead to the call off by
Killanoy,
and four points.
Yeah, 4 points for Windy City as we move into jam number seven, which will be brought to you by Rydell. Make your skates your own with custom colored, handcrafted Color Lab boots by Rydell Skates. And I do love color, so make sure you get some fancy Color Lab boots.
Well, I love the color of your
lipstick. Post pictures of them.
It's gorgeous. And aww. I can imagine some beautiful boots in that shade, too.
Nice bright blue. Mm-hmm. All works out.
And back in play, Maddie Masochist for Santa Cruz. Shake and bake out there for Windy City. Multiplayer block penalty called on one of the Windy City skaters. That is 3-5-0.
That's Rachel Rage. And it also, Shake and Bake is going to have a seat for a track cut. So not only is it 4-on-2 in the pack in favor of Santa Cruz, it's also a power jam for Maddie Masochist, who is now lead jammer for Santa Cruz as well.
Rita Hateworthy back on the track for Windy City. So now they're up to three strength, about to almost be full strength on the blocker line, but jammer still frozen in the box there.
So this is the seventh jam of the half here, and this is only the second lead going to Santa Cruz in the half.
So a bit of quite a switch from the first half where we saw Santa Cruz controlling the play most of the first.
4 points scored on the first scoring pass there by Maddie Masochist as the power jam is now over, both teams at full strength.
And Shake and Bake with a forearm call.
Well, you can get out, but that's not the way you want to do it as power jam will move on.
Yeah, Shake and Bake visibly frustrated with that feeling. I finally made it out of the pack. It has been a tough go for either jammer on either team because these defensive-minded blockers have shut the door wherever they can.
Jam gets called off as Shake and Bake stood up in the box. So that will end jam number eight, and we are seeing a timeout taken. I believe this will be a team timeout for Windy City.
Yeah, they have all three still left.
Yeah, so because they use their official review as a clock stoppage. And this is Shake and Bake where, interesting, this is the replay here, and that's stood up in bounds. That was the cut, if I remember correctly. Yep, that is indeed where the cut happened. So went down, and I kind of wonder if Shake and Bake, if she stood up, because she may have saw that the person who knocked her down went out or something along those lines. And now back on this replay, you can see Maddie Masochist. I'm just watching. This is just enjoyable to watch. I'm sorry for those of you out there on the audio feed.
And just to see the reforming blockers, it's the awareness from both teams has just been incredible. And when we talk about penalties, as we are talking about right now, because we're going to start the next jam with a power start for Santa Cruz.
We'll be moving into jam number eight, by the way, with 15 minutes and 41 seconds left to go. The score is 97-62. In favor of Santa Cruz, but as you were saying, I'm sorry.
Windy City does have number 622. That's Kidney Lauper, who's been doing phenomenal work on the track, but also racking up some penalties. She's sitting at 5, the most of any skater out there at this time.
And our next jam brought to you by Adam Skates. Adam Skate packages give you the most bang for your buck. AdamSkates.com.
And it's Terra Tot with the power start for Santa Cruz. Meanwhile, Shake and Bake just released from the penalty box. Skirting in, could take advantage of being unnoticed. Not quite. Santa Cruz definitely ready for her at the top of the pack.
Shake and Bake stuck in turn number one, and both teams playing exclusive defense at this point.
Yeah, that line of Bork, Bork, Bork is making a lot of work, work, work for Terratot.
I see what you did there. That almost, it kind of almost rhymes.
And Shake and Bake out with Leap and really had to fight for that almost 40 seconds into the jam.
That's solid resilience to come out of the box, gain lead, and then that, and then Terratot with a track cut. So this is going to be Power Jam Windy City.
And that's how the game goes, back and forth. Another cut track call, though, and this time it's on Shake and Bake. So they'll be switching seats in the penalty box.
So this is interesting, by the way. This is jam number eight. When it times out, because it's going to go the full 2 minutes, we will be at 13 minutes and about 40 seconds. Mm-hmm. When you have eight jams that go almost 17 minutes, that's pretty long, and especially in this time of short jams.
And as we mentioned, the longer that clock runs, and with this almost stalemate-type scoring that we're seeing, Santa Cruz, of course, has the advantage being in the lead right now.
Yeah, 35 points separating these two teams. But, of course, with 25 seconds left to go in the jam, both jammers now eligible to score as Terratot has completed the initial. Shake and Bake on the first scoring pass now out of the box.
Shake and Bake coming up against R2-D2-Nate, whose hands are behind her back and just letting her push. Meanwhile, Cassie Beck also providing support at the front of the line there for Santa Cruz.
Jam times out. 2 points will be, I'm sorry, 3 points will be added to both sides. So basically, it was a wash. That whole thing was a wash.
A lot of work, though, for a wash. Santa Cruz now at the century mark, Windy City 65.
So we are going to take a look at the replay here as Shake and Bake gets nudged out, and then Cassie Beck gets knocked out by Bork, 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 and then Shake and Bake re-enters, and that's where the cut happened, because I believe she re-entered in front of two of her own teammates that were behind her when she went out. That's why.
Paying attention to your teammates, and wow, what a fast lead jammer status assessed to Vasquez, but Erex also right behind her, pack moving a little faster than we've seen, now holding fast in turn two. Vasquez wanting to get some points, trusting that her blockers there will hold back Erex, and it has paid off so far. She's able to collect four. Erex still at the back of the pack.
It is 100-69 now, thanks to that 4 points picked up. And a penalty
assessed.
Is it assessed? No, it is. It is a back block. I did not see the jammer ref echoing the penalty. So this is Power Jam Windy City.
And paid off for Vasquez, who decided not to try to call to shut out Santa Cruz, rather. But we'll see how things go in this game. It has been back and forth with jammer penalties.
Windy City's bench was frantically asking for a call-off there as a completion of the second scoring pass. So points in pocket for Erex there. 3 points scored for Santa Cruz, eight for Windy City, 103-73 as we end jam number nine.
And here we see the moment that Erex coming out on the outside line, running through to the inside.
Next jam will be brought to you by S1 Helmets, the S1 Lifer Helmet, best hit, best fit, superior protection, made for roller derby. Get a lifer, be a lifer.
And our power start started with a bit of a fall, a wall fall, if you will, but it still works in Killinoy's favor, grabbing lead jammer status within 5 seconds. And as that happens, Erex now out of the box as Killinoy is going on her first scoring trip through the pack, able to capitalize on the inside line, left wide open there as Santa Cruz was providing offense for, oh, look at that, R2-D2-Nate now with the star for Santa Cruz.
I mean, they were providing offense. It was just R2-D2-Nate on the star pass. Is Killinoy now has completed one scoring pass, now on the second, and R2-D2-Nate has completed the first scoring pass, trading a knowing smile to each other as they swoop around the track.
R2-D2-Nate coming up against Regina Spector, getting by on the outside of turn three, which has been a lot of trouble for some of the jammers this game. That's where some track cuts have occurred, but she stays inbound and safe. And we'll see how it works out here. Windy City Rollers picking up 11 points.
And then Santa Cruz will get 8 as jam number 10 comes to a conclusion. We'll have about 10 minutes left on the clock when jam 11 kicks off.
And there we see the moment where the pileup occurs and that beautiful star pass. Yeah. Over to R2-D2-Nate.
That was great speed
Sneaky.
Control as well by R2-D2-Nate to not only get out, but also speed up to where Killanoi was and then pick up two scoring passes in that.
And great awareness to know it's time to focus on the offense's defense, get our pivot out with the star, start scoring points. And in this gem, it is gem 11, Maddie Masochist with the star for Santa Cruz. Ice hurt for Windy City. Packed now between turns 1 and 2. And that number 75, Bork, 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 just causing so much trouble out there. Love and life at the back of the pack to draw back even further, and that's why Maddie Masochist is now on that wall.
That's always been a specialty of Bork, Bork, Bork in all of her history, skating for Windy City all these years, has been drawing back big, big hits. Everything Bork has done in all of her time, just a joy to watch Bork skate.
And it's an art to be able to draw back, to have the clarity and awareness to know where those lines are. So what a treat for everybody out here. And we have a wonderful audience in Winston-Salem, North Carolina today. Meanwhile, back on the track, Ice Hurt being patient, but also now being caught in a cluster there on the straightaway into turn 3. Both teams at full strength with their blockers, too, so lots in the way. Santa Cruz not sure where exactly to place themselves.
Bork, Bork, Bork will head to the penalty box here as Ice Hurts. Gains lead jammer status after a minute 30 of waiting to get it picked up.
These jams have been a lot of work for these skaters. I mean, when you're seeing lead jammer assessed so late in the jam, but now hoping to pick up any point she can, decides instead to call it.
3 points scored there by Windy City is going to make it 111-87 with 8 minutes left to go here in the game. Jam number 11 just ended. Let's take a look here at the replay. Ice Hurt trying to move to the inside, getting sort of shut down by Santa Cruz's quickly reforming defense.
Looking back, wondering where her blockers are. And a timeout called.
Yeah, timeout called by Santa Cruz. This is their final team timeout. They will have one stoppage left in their official review. So that gives me a lot of good time to tell you about
it,
our friends at Derby
does.
Without Borders, a unique equipment distribution program that collects new and used skate gear to donate to roller derby leagues who need it across the planet. Find out who you can support at derbywithoutborders.org. One of the best roller derby charities I can think of. I mean, they break down barriers of accessibility to roller derby around the world. It's a very expensive sport to participate in. I mean, you look at most skate packages, you can talk easily $600, $700 United States dollars. And then you factor in things like helmets, wrist guards, knee pads, mouth guards. It's an expensive sport to play, and Derby Without Borders helps to get roller derby in the hands of those who cannot afford it.
And of course, maintaining all your equipment once you fall in love with the sport.
Oh, yeah.
And you keep doing it for years and years.
Proper skate maintenance is something that is difficult to learn and very expensive to keep up.
Definitely. And here we go, winding down that Santa Cruz timeout. They, as mentioned, used all three of their allotted timeouts.
Going back to the penalty side of things, 11 jammer penalties for Windy City and 7 for Santa Cruz.
And Windy City blocker number 622, Kidney Lauper, sitting dangerously close to her limits with penalties at 6 right now. Of course, 7 and you foul out.
Vasquez not worried too much about that right now as she has gone out and gained lead for Windy City. 7.5 minutes left to go in the game. Now is the time to make that break.
Oh, look how quickly she was able to circle around there on the outside lane of turn 1. Pack barely moving. She's able to pick up 4.
Star has been passed to R2-D2-Nate for Santa Cruz.
And R2-D2-Nate coming in a little fast, but still safe, although a blocker from Windy City sent to the penalty box there. I believe that's Regina Spector. It is. Vasquez waiting patiently on the line there on that toe stop to move back in on the track and pick up 4 points.
Santa Cruz has been using R2D in a very smart way as she has been very calm out there when receiving the star pass, but Vasquez not bothered by that at all. Fourth scoring pass completed, 16 points thus far in the jam with still 45 seconds left to go in the jam.
Wow, a massive jam for Windy City and
it's
Vasquez.
It's still going.
It is still going.
Vasquez is thinking about calling it though and does.
Is really happy with that effort there.
18-8 on the jam here for Windy City. That's going to close the gap down to 14 points with 6 minutes to go. Jam number 12 ends as Death Nella. My goodness, this has gotten fun.
And here we see a replay moment of Vasquez. That's the, no need to slow down. I'm just going to move on through turn
two. The backwards one skate turn on the outside lane. That takes some skill.
Yeah, and she didn't have to slow down at all. And here we see E-Rex with the start for Santa Cruz trying to even things out. Killanoi for Windy City. And by even things out, I mean grab lead, which she does do.
This is only the third lead jammer status going to Santa Cruz on the 13th jam of the half.
And that's where we're seeing Windy City edge in. Windy City now, Killanoi out of the pack. About a half lap behind now coming in to turn one. E-Rex calling it off.
3 points were scored there by E-Rex. It's going to make it a 122-109 game as Windy City had a stockpile of timeouts. They're going to use one of them here. So team timeout gives me a little bit of time to tell you about our friends at Powerdyne. If a maneuverable and reactive plate is what you're looking for, then look no further than the Arius Platinum from Powerdyne. Arius Platinum is performance redefined, part of the Rydell family.
Well, Windy City coming out and showing up in this second half.
5 minutes and 11 seconds is where we're frozen at. 13 jams into the second half. And Nella, we've mentioned the penalties in the second half. Let's do a tale of two halves, really. 25 penalties for Windy City in the first half, 14 for Santa Cruz in the first half. But then you go into the second half, and it's 17 for Windy City and then 18 for Santa Cruz. So it's been dead even in that second half. And you can really see Windy City has made up a lot of that gap that they were facing at the half.
Yeah, and Santa Cruz blockers, of course, coming up against full strength blocking lines from Windy City that have just stopped them right where they thought that, hey, it was easy to get lead.
Windy City also still has a team timeout in addition to the official review. Santa Cruz can only stop the clock on their official review.
And here we see Maddie Masochist getting caught up on Bork Bork Bork, who does get sent to the penalty box. Now on her, that was her sixth penalty, and we do have Maddie Masochist out in front with lead.
All right, so that's going to be the fourth lead for Santa Cruz in the half compared to nine for Windy City, but Ice Hurt is out. Yeah. Maddie Masochist is in the pack scoring and out of the pack now, completion of the first scoring pass.
Of course, Santa Cruz will need to get lead to maintain their lead in the game.
So Jam 14 comes to a conclusion with 4 minutes, and there will be almost exactly 4 minutes left as we move into the replay.
And there we see Maddie Masochist able to get by that last blocker there, that 62 Kidney Lopper, who of course needs to play clean if she wants to stay in the game. There are now two Windy City blockers with six penalties apiece.
And Kidney Lopper and also Bork 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 now. But Vasquez out and lead for Windy City.
And it looks like the wind is at her back because she is speeding around the track.
Tifa Knox are about a quarter of the track length behind.
Trying to get some assistance there by R2-D2 Nate. And it appears to be a power jam situation for Vasquez of Windy City, because of a track cut call on Tifa Knoxhart, or a forearm, told.
It was a forearm, that is correct. So now Vasquez has already put 4 points on the board, now in the second scoring pass.
Windy City losing Bork Bork Bork, though, to the penalty box, and she won't be returning back to the track after this one.
Vasquez calls off the jam to freeze Tifa Noxhard in the box. So this will be a power start when we move into jam number 16.
As well, there is a Santa Cruz blocker. And as mentioned, Bork, who was sent to the penalty box, she will be now on her seventh and final penalty. So she's been fouled out of the game. And another skater is taking her place. Here's another look at Vasquez, who seems, doesn't matter what direction you're facing.
Yeah, survives the hit, gets out, and now we're back in action. 14 points separating these two teams. 2 minutes, 30 seconds left on the game clock.
Tifa Noxhard now out on the track.
Killanoi able to get around on turn number two, out and lead, but Tifa Noxhard right behind.
Windy City speeding up the pack. Santa Cruz actually as well. Windy City's at the back of the pack. So Killanoi will have to go just a little bit further to try to collect more points. Pack spread out enough to call a no-pack situation, but Tifa travels with Santa Cruz. Tifa taking off the star, trying to create some confusion possibly. Of course, she can collect points right now if she has the star on her head.
I think that's a gamble because, you know, if she it didn't pay off, no points were scored. That's an interesting one because if she removed the helmet cover while still potentially accumulating points, I mean, it was a gamble. Maybe she was thinking she'd already gotten the points. I don't know. That was a tough call.
It was an interesting decision nonetheless because you want to get every little bit you can, the gap narrowing. Here we see that moment.
Looking to see if maybe this is where Tifa Noxhard removed the helmet cover. No, this is where Tifa Noxhard got out.
Or Killanoi, rather, well, for Windy City.
So team timeout here. Windy City is taking their final team timeout, 126 to 115. And this here, you can see Killanoi getting floored by the Santa Cruz pack and then recycled back.
And that was the moment as well where the Santa Cruz helmet cover came off.
So we want to give a special thank you to Derby City Skate Strong Athletic, the Texas Roller Girls, Derby City Designs, Chicks and Bulls, Rydell, Radar Wheels, Powerdyne, and RollerCon as we will go into what could potentially be a final jam. We have a minute 36 left on our frozen clock. Both teams do have a clock stoppage in the form of their official review. So this is interesting because if Windy City gets out and lead, they're three scoring passes away from retaking the lead and the win. Santa Cruz is basically just on the clock to play defense.
And Vasquez has the star for Windy City.
E-Rex is out there for Santa Cruz.
Both jammers coming up against a cluster of skaters. E-Rex more towards the front right now. Vasquez caught up on the back there of Heloise.
This defense is working out in Santa Cruz's favor. It's taking time off the clock as Vasquez now approaching the inside lane. Could get out. No, E-Rex is out and lead.
And the Santa Cruz bench up on their feet, on their skates, what you will. Crowd watching intently as the action's taking place in turn two. Right, in front of the fan zone.
Yeah, there was communication between E-Rex and the bench about what strategy to take on this one.
And Vasquez out on her initial with the star in hand. Star now back on the helmet, looking to score some points.
I mean, I think E-Rex and Santa Cruz are probably smart to run this one because at this point it's just trading laps.
But E-Rex, knowing her track awareness there, saying, yeah, that was just a nowhere and pass. It already collected 4 points, so picks up that full set there on that pass.
E-Rex now in the pack for the second scoring pass. 24 seconds left on the jam clock. Or sorry, on the game clock. There's still 43 seconds left on the jam clock. And Vasquez getting brought all the way back around to the pivot line. I kind of wonder if E-Rex is going to call it here in just a couple of seconds. E-Rex has come to a stop.
Well, she's gotten a countdown from her bench and has called the jam.
Waiting for the final accumulation of points. Looks like 4 will be added for Santa Cruz and 3 for Windy City. Nell, I think we have an unofficial final.
We certainly do. The unofficial final, Santa Cruz 134 against Windy City 118. That second half, though, Steffi, came alive.
It came alive as I almost died.
There's so much going on, so much tension and drama in this entire venue. There's the moment of E-Rex knowing that she got lead and got control of the game. An incredible effort by Windy City and Santa Cruz.
Yeah, that went really, really well. I think for both sides, especially as you see the replay here where E-Rex came right back in. There was Vasquez on the top there, just swooping in.
Vasquez, of course, collecting so many beautiful multi-scoring jams for Windy City. Lots to take home and be proud of. And that second half, especially with Windy City recollecting their thoughts, obviously picking their focus and intention for the second half and coming in. Of course, penalty troubles for both sides, really.
We do have an official final now, as you mentioned, Ethnella. It is 134 to 118. Still to come, we have our semifinals. Don't forget there is a 30-minute gap in between there. But
pizza,
that's going to be
friends,
fun.
Pizza, whatever you need.
Everything you need. Pizza and friends, that's really all you need. It's going to be a good time. We still have a lot to come here today. And really, I think this was a big... I still think this is a moral victory here for Windy City, considering where they were at the end of the half. To come back like this, to go from like a 45-point or so deficit to be within 16 points, I think that's pretty good.
And to overcome a really penalty-heavy first half, as we talked about, lots of power jams for Santa Cruz that they were able to take advantage of, it all adds up. And so a really great effort by both teams. A fun game as well in venue. I love the crowd that's here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And of course, if you want to go to the next event, playoffs, hey, guess what? It's next week. So if your weekend is free, you want to head down to Seattle, you can do that. Or Steffi has all the information about how you can watch from home again.
Yeah, you definitely can. You can go to WFTDA.tv. Or if you're in the Seattle area, tickets are still available. So you can go ahead and check those out at WFTDA.com/. I believe it's tickets, but... And you just go to WFTDA.com anyway. You should just go there.
And if you're new to the WFTDA postseason, the reason why playoffs is so important is, of course, that spot to championships in Montreal, mid-November. It's very exciting, and that's what we're playing for in the next game. But now we're going to head on over to Standby, who has one of our winning skaters.
Shamrock and Roller, to be specific.
For aid of Santa Cruz, Shamrock and Roller. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And both teams in this game met with upsets earlier in the first round. Can you tell us how Santa Cruz, kind of a loaded question, was able to bounce back today?
It was really about focusing back on our gameplay. We realized that in the Paris game, we got away from how we play our game. So our focus today was play for each other, play our game that we wanted to play, and go out with all the love and intensity and high fives that we can do.
All right. Well, it's Facebook official. This is your final game. So. Thinking another loaded question, last chance here. Thinking about all your career moments, what is the highlight? What is the takeaway?
The takeaway is just the love of the game. I mean, I really, really, truly love roller derby, and it, you know, they say over there, like, roller derby can change the world, and it changed my life in so many ways, and I'm so thankful for it.
Awesome. All right. Well, who or what inspired you to get into roller derby, and who or what has been your inspiration lately?
Blackjack over there. Yeah, she's my inspiration lately. I was just going through a really hard time in my life, and I always played organized sports growing up, and I actually roller skated artistically when I was young, and I played water polo, and one day my dad goes, you know, it'd be so great if you could find a sport that incorporated your skating and water polo and put them together. And the next day there was an article in the newspaper about a team opening, starting in Santa Cruz, and so it was just kismet.
All right. And finally, what advice would you give to the aspiring championship all-stars watching right now?
Again, just play for the love of the game. Play for your teammates. Play for the sport. Play for the community.
Awesome. Thank you again. And next up, semifinals begin with Dos Por Cuatro in Texas right here on WFTDA. Thanks again.
Thank you.